The Media Dialogues, Vision 2020.
Hello, in this special series, we are putting together a panoramic view of the dynamic media landscape we inhabit. Our consumption of media has changed dramatically as a result of both technological breakthroughs and regulatory actions. DTH, or direct-to-home satellite TV, has become really popular in cities as well as in far-flung remote areas after the set-top box via the conditional access system paved the way for pay TV. 15 years later, yeah, all that happened in the last 15 years or so, DTH is almost neck and neck, if not overtaken cable. But it's also facing a new phenomenon in some cities, and that is of people cutting the cord. To share his take on challenges and opportunities, I'm joined by Harit Nagpal, Managing Director and CEO of India's largest DTH service provider with close to 18 million subscribers. Tata Sky launched in 2006 and has led the industry in offering digital personal video recording and customized content. Harit, thank you for coming over and sharing all these insights on the industry.
Thank you for having me, Anuradha. Good to have you back on CNBC again.
Thank you, Harit. Now, tell me, to use a phrase from all the advertising Tata Sky has created, is life jingalala today for people in the DTH business?
Life jingalala has been jingalala, will remain jingalala.
Tell me, where are the growth opportunities? Is it the 100 million homes that still don't have connections in India?
See, to get to the growth opportunities and where we've been getting the growth and where we're going to get the growth from, you've got to imagine a pyramid,
okay,
the income pyramid,
sure,
where the richest people live on the top and the bottom is the economically poorer. The bottom 100 million homes do not have a television opportunity.
Right.
The next 35 million homes do not subscribe to pay TV. They're on free-to-air opportunity.
Right.
The remaining 120, 130 million that's left on top is divided half and half between DTH and cable opportunity. Because what happens is that in the new regime of the tariff order, a customer needs to make a choice.
Yes.
He has the choice of paying for what he wants to watch. And watching needs change month on month.
Yeah.
And television in India is a family product. So it's not one individual's preferences. There are five people or six people sitting at home watching the TV, and all their preferences also add to the... So anybody, any operator today needs to have an online, real-time, channel-changing or pack-changing mechanism made available to the customer.
Right.
He has to have huge investments in the customer operations infrastructure so that he can support the customer through voice or through data to make his changes, to choose his pack, to figure out.
So you're saying it's not just 135 million homes, but more than that, that growth opportunity, that provide you growth opportunities.
There is growth from within the pay TV subscriber base. There is 35 million of free-to-air who will, some part of it, eventually migrate to pay. And there is 100 million non-TV homes which will move to free-to-air and then to pay.
Right. So why is it that in cities, and I'm hearing people like me say that, oh, we don't need to renew our subscription to a DTH service provider or a digital cable operator. Why is that happening? Because I can access whatever broadcasters are offering me through broadcast OTT platforms. I have a range of streaming services that are purely subscription OTT platforms. And even you have an OTT platform. So why do I need to get your box at all?
When the passenger car was invented, did the bus or the railroad go out of fashion? Because the purpose of the passenger car as well as the bus is to take you from point A to point B. The car is like the OTT. Doesn't mean that the bus will go out of fashion. There'll be people who will be using their personal cars, and there'll be people who will be using the public transport, which is the cable and the satellite.
So what is to use your analogy, what number of people are we looking at who are using cars, or in this case, perhaps purely consuming content through the internet, through OTT?
Yeah, so our estimate says that there are about 3 million homes in the country who are paying more than about 600 rupees per month for watching content. Now, these are the people who can afford another 1,000 rupees a month for the medium.
Right.
For the broadband or the 3G or the 4G or whatever you may have. The others will primarily be on. Now, this 3 million will obviously increase, but it won't become 30 million and 40 million and 50 million. This 3 will go to 5 to 10 to 15 or whatever.
Okay.
And also these 3 million or 4 million or 5 million, whatever they are not going to switch off the TV. It's about and in India. It's not about or.
So, this cutting the cord is an overstatement, you're
cutting
saying?
Cutting the cord is an overstatement because, you know, the people who've got an OTT device at home have not switched off their TV.
You're not seeing that, you're not seeing subscribers not renew their subscriptions.
We haven't noticed any such thing. In fact, because television is a family product, there is always somebody in the house who wants to watch the television on television.
So, Harit, the new tariff order, much delayed, was finally implemented earlier this year. We know the rationale was to provide transparency and even affordability because people, because they had choice, could select exactly which channel they wanted and pay just for those. How has that played out when it comes to consumption patterns and habits of your subscribers?
Customers first suddenly were barraged with a whole lot of information, didn't know what to do. On one side, there was a message that was coming to them that your prices are going to go down. On the other side, they were asked to choose the channels they wanted to watch and delete the ones they didn't want to watch if they wanted to maintain their price. Now, a customer feels that if he's deprived of the channel which was coming, even though he wasn't watching on television, he feels that his prices have gone up. And who does he go to?
Interesting psychology.
Yeah, it is. I mean, that's exactly what happened. He said, on one side, I'm hearing that the prices are going to go down. On the other side, I had these channels on my portfolio and I can't get them. So, how are the prices? For the same price, I should not get less channels. While we were saying that you can choose your channels and decide what you pay. So, that interaction had to be managed by us, which meant millions of interactions and throwing in a whole lot of people in the call centers and online and we're getting our dealers to answer the questions. So the team has had to work over time for a very long time.
Would you say this was a big disruption in the business?
It was a huge disruption in the business. In fact, A, on one side, it changed our relationship with the broadcasters because we used to buy in fixed, do fixed deals for long term with them. And then decide our prices to the customer and make our own bouquets. So that process had to be reworked all over. Second, it was like every customer's pack needed to be changed. Now,
and as frequently as they wanted.
As frequently. So you needed to put together a mechanism by way of which he could go. And everybody is not net savvy. So you had to teach your dealers also to do that. You had to teach your call centers to you know, speak a new language. You had to create a new app on which it. So, it was a lot of hard work.
The regulator would say that you all had, and it was delayed, so you all had 2 years to prepare for
Anuradha, it was mandated whenever it was mandated. So was CAS and so was DAS. In what form would it come was not firm, really. And whether it would come or not, it was like a wolf which kept coming, coming, and you know, it suddenly came the beginning of this year. So, no matter how much time you give us, these things happen only when they happen. And we were the best prepared of the lot, I mean, I must say, and which is why we were able to manage the transition most smoothly.
How has this change impacted consumption patterns? Do you see people actually going in for far lesser channels? Because I know there's some TRAI figure floating around that 80% of people actually watch less than 40 channels. You know, has that borne true? And also affordability, because anecdotally when you speak to people, it has been my cable TV bill, my DTH bill has gone up and people are smarting from that.
Well, it had to, because in the previous regime, when the stakeholders, which is the broadcasters and the government, were not getting paid by a fairly large proportion of the distribution platforms. And now in the new tariff regime, if you bring all that in order and everybody has to pay what he's supposed to pay, then obviously the price table will go up a little. And like I said, if I was getting certain channels for a price and now I'm getting lesser number of channels for a price,
it's going to feel like I'm paying more.
So even that's played off. So saying to making announcements that your TV bill will come down, I think was the wrong move. It should have all been about convenience of choosing what you want to watch and not about, so it's about value for money, not about cheapness. Television in India is, as it is, multiple times cheaper than most countries in Southeast Asia. Forget about Europe and America. I mean, at our current prices, we are at about $4 per home or something like that. Our neighboring countries are selling at 20 and 25 and 30 and $40. US, UK, $100 per subscription.
You know, now that there is some post-new tariff order equilibrium, would you say that people are actually switching in and out, opting in and out based on the content that's on? For instance, you had the World Cup cricket, ODI World Cup in June, right? So would I switch on Star Sports and switch it off?
I can give you a small
statistic. What are you noticing?
Even today, 8 months after, or 8 or 9 months or whatever, after the tariff order implementation, about 30-35% of our base makes one change online to their pack.
30% of your
30%
base.
Of the base every month makes a change at least.
So Harit, in this 30% population that is actually making changes on a monthly basis to the packs that they subscribe to, what is seeing the most change? Is it, you know, is it channels like sports channels which have big ticket properties
what
and
is
then
happening,
don't
what is really
months?
Happening is that people are still getting used to the channels they have, the channels they want to watch and the channels they don't have. So there are five or six people watching the television in the house. And, you know, as time passes, people are realizing, oh, I wanted to watch that. It's not there. Something is coming. Let me just subscribe to that channel or that pack. Or children are visiting, children are going out, old people are visiting, old people are going out, their rooms get activated, get deactivated. So all that is happening online.
As we close the year where you saw this big disruption via the new tariff order, what is a lesson that's a takeaway, or what is something that you would want to share with the regulator?
Well, yes, there was a big change we've been through. We're still reeling from the after effects of that. But there are almost about two new tariff orders coming out, two new consultation papers coming out every fortnight or so. I've lost count. There must have been 15, 16 in the last 6 months.
Are you trying to say that there's over-regulation?
Yes, there is a little bit of an over-regulation, the sense of over-regulation. And then, you know, what happens is, when there is over-regulation, it takes you to uncertainty, and then you're scared to invest. So one is not very comfortable, because if the changes continue and they don't stabilize, then you think before you invest. So that's one part. And I also feel that, yes, content needs to be regulated in the sense that, and there is a good amount of self-regulation in the content from the broadcaster side already. But when you have 800 plus channels in the country, you have four large DTH operators, you have in every geography about three cable operators. So a customer has a choice of seven distribution platforms from which he can select. In that environment, controlling prices also, I don't think it's a great idea.
So the price cap has been detrimental to the growth of the industry?
Yeah, because
and not just the DTH guys.
If I want
down
to,
the chain.
If I want to offer a better service and customer wants to subscribe to that service versus the others. If my price is controlled and I don't have the choice of taking the price little up for a little more price for much better service, then I can't do that. Because if I'm not going to get a premium for my superior service and
why
the customer is willing to pay for that slight premium, why would I invest? So that's the, and you know, we haven't done that for toothpaste. We haven't done that for soap. And there are more people who use toothpaste or soap in this country than watch TV. Then why control the prices for this segment?
Right. And the fact that the agreements or the deals between broadcasters and DTH platforms and other platforms, distribution platforms, the fact that these now need to be transparent, is that going to be
transparency is not
a problem?
The issue, but freedom to strike a price or strike a deal between a seller and a buyer was something that was working fine.
How much of a hurdle will this be?
See, this is leading to price control. If everybody's got to be sold at the same price, then that's leading to price control.
What's the way out and the way forward?
I guess in the short term, once the things stabilize, even the regulator will open up the market and allow platforms to decide the prices, platforms to create the packages, and also charge a bit of a premium if I'm offering a superior service, as long as the customer is willing to pay. And in a competitive scenario, a platform like us cannot charge more than what the customer is willing to pay or more than an equivalent competitor. Mm.
We began this conversation with you saying everything is jingalala, and you dismissed my apprehensions of cord cutting and the fact that OTT was going to be an overwhelming, is growing overwhelmingly and would be a real challenge for DTH and even for broadcasters.
I don't think it will be a challenge for us because we are in the business of aggregation and distribution. And now that OTT is raising its head and is getting to decent numbers, we ourselves have gone into the business of OTT.
With Binge.
With Binge. So we have launched a product called Binge, which our subscribers can subscribe to. We'll give you a free device. And you pay us a monthly subscription and you get access to Hotstar, Amazon Prime, Z5, Eros Now, SunNext, etc., etc. And, you know, more content is getting added there.
So you're saying that there is, that while all these disruptions are happening, they're all opportunities at this point of
time. Yes, they are. And there are different types of customers wanting to watch different types of content through different mediums. And we'll make them available through every one of them.
Okay. Harit, we are, I cannot but help talk about the growth rate of the economy because that is headline everywhere. And we are seeing the GDP figure for second quarter has come in at 4.5%. So the entire year's GDP growth figure has also been, you know, revised down or is being revised down. How is the economy and how it's doing impacting your business?
Not yet. In fact, I do travel a lot towards the villages, meet with customers almost about 2 to 3 days in a month. I end up going and meeting customers in various villages. I have not seen people consuming less television. I mean, there are homes which don't have furniture, but they will definitely have a TV. The whole family watches it at different times of the day, different programs. Their TV viewing habits have not reduced. In fact, half of the villages that I go to still have a box TV. The other half have a flat screen, LED, smaller size though, TV. And when you talk to the people who have a box TV, each one of them has an intention to replace that box with a flat screen TV in the next year or two. So it's such an essential product where the family spends about 4 or 5 hours a day in front of it that, you know, it's difficult to take them that out of their lives.
Harit, what a tumultuous time this has been for the media landscape. And you've come to it via the route of FMCG and telecom after that, right? When you look at it today, like I said sometime back, that we are on the cusp of a new year, but we are also closing down a decade. So 20 years of the media landscape is what it is, you know, today. What are some of the key milestones, would you say, or the key highlights or headlines for you?
People are watching more TV than yesterday. People always said that people will watch less TV, but I'm seeing the TV consumption growing with the content coming in. Even the broadcasters are doing a great job in terms of bringing in new formats, and that helps us because we don't produce content, but we're looking forward to the broadcasters creating more content and newer kind of content which will glue the customers in. And
do you see a possibility of creating content? I mean, you know, Zomato is making content now,
no,
so why not?
I've been
Tata
a purist. I've been a purist all my life, really. You know, I see jobs being cut. For example, we are good at managing customers, doing deals with the broadcasters, and for example, 500,000 customers go to zero balance in the morning every morning.
Wow!
By the night, we have to bring them all, recharge the, make them recharge with 20 rupees, 30, 50, 100, 200 rupees, and the next morning another 500,000 will be without. So we know that well. We understand boxes, we understand wires, we understand dishes, we understand satellite.
And you understand what customers
and what
want
customers
when they call
want,
you.
What price are they willing to pay, etc. We don't understand whether the husband should die at the end of the soap or the sister should get married. I mean, that's something that they know. We understand this and we'd like to stay here.
Okay. Harit Nagpal, thank you very much for coming and shedding light. And the fact is, and the headline from this conversation is that there is a great deal of opportunity, but maybe a little less regulation would help.
I guess, yes. Thank you.
Thank you,
pleasure.
Harit. And we'll be back again next week with another such conversation. So do look out for the Media Dialogues Vision 2020.
The Media Dialogues Vision 2020.